angels from the realms of glory, wing your flight over all the earth. Ye who sang creation's story, now proclaim Messiah's birth. Come and worship, come and worship, worship Christ the Lord King. Saints before the altar bending, watching, longing, hope and fear. Suddenly the Lord descending in his temple shall appear. Come and worship, come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King.
I don't know if Rachel's making an altar call there. Just a couple things before we open with prayer here. I have Doug and Jan are not with us here this morning. They drove out to Sioux Falls to be with their grandkids. And then tomorrow, Doug is actually having back surgery. So if you keep Doug and Jan in their prayers. Freddie Grossman's sick, so if you remember him in prayer. And we have Ken and Sheila, who often do breakfast for us. I heard that Sheila, actually her mom, had died. So I believe that is correct, right? So if you can remember Sheila, Krita in prayer, and Ken. We also have Eddie's mom, Annie. She's just not doing very well. If you pray for some medical concerns for his mom, and pray for Eddie also, just that he knows that his mom's going to be peaceful and not pain, and be pain-free, is probably a big piece for Eddie. We have Albie Hines on here. If you continue to remember Albie in prayer, and his mom, Shirley. We have Carla Pelkey. I believe she's still in pain, but I know... hopefully she'll get to the doctor here soon, and she had the broken pelvis, so we want to continue to keep her and Jack in prayer. We have Dina and Missy Adams. Want to remember them with Mike's passing. So if you please remember Dina and Missy. And we have Judy Geeler, who's not with us here today, but Herman says she's doing really well. She's doing better and getting stronger every single day, and so just continue to remember Judy and Herman in prayer. Ronnie had some tests. The tests came back very well, and but we have probably the bigger tests coming up this week. If you would remember Ronnie in prayer, and that we get, you know, just an understanding where that cough is coming from is a key piece, is to understanding why some of the things are happening to him. And my dad's surgery is set for December 18th. And is there any other prayer requests this morning? All right, let's open with prayer then. Now, dear Heavenly Father, Father, again, we just thank you for Christ. We're so thankful that you love the sinners the way we are, and that you sent your Son, Jesus, to die on the cross for our sins, who was buried, and then he rose again the third day, showing us the payment for sin has been paid in full. And Father, we're so thankful for this gift, the gift of eternal life that we receive in Christ when we believe the gospel of salvation, the gospel of Christ, and we're so thankful for that. We know that we can never be good enough, not follow any ritual or deed or sacrament to be saved. It is completely by believing, and believing only in the Word of God, because we know thy Word is truth, and that is what thy Word preaches. And Father, we have many prayer requests this morning, and we just ask that you'd be with Doug and Jan Patterson. Father, we just pray that they would have a wonderful Christmas with their granddaughters out in Sioux Falls, that you would be with them traveling there. Father, I absolutely love Doug and Jan, just doing such a wonderful blessing, great part of the church here. And Father, we just ask that you'd be with Doug tomorrow as he has surgery there on his back, and that you would guide the medical instruments, and that you'd, you know, give the guy doctor the healing of his back there, Father. And Father, we just ask that you'd be with Jan, his wonderful wife, beautiful wife there, and that you would give her comfort tomorrow, and that she could lean on you, and she could pray, and that she could find comfort in your arms, that everything's going to be okay, that her husband is going to be absolutely all right there, Father. So we ask that you'd be with them tomorrow, as we know you are. But we pray for that for them this morning. We pray for our brother Freddie, that you would heal him there, Father, that you would bring him back healthy and as ever, and just be with him today. You'd be with Sheila and Ken Krita. We just, you know, they're here often every Sunday, the first of every month, and helping out with the breakfast there, Father. We know today that we ask that you'd be with them, and our thoughts and prayers are with them. For I can't even imagine how tough it is to lose a mom or a dad, and we do have some people here that have lost a mom and a dad. But Father, we just ask that you'd be with Sheila today, that she could find peace. And Father, we just pray that they've trusted in the gospel, that her mom was saved, their Father. We pray that you'd be with Carla Pelkey, Jack. And we just ask, so thankful that you've kind of given her a little bit of peace, kind of a little bit of respite there, Father. We know that she's still in pain, but I think she's a little bit more calmer and comfortable than before. So we just ask that you'd be with her, and that you'd get her the doctor that she needs so she can be healed there, Father. And we pray that you'd be with Jack and then with his new job, and that he would continue to spread the gospel, as that was part of the decision to taking the new job. Pray that, so thankful that the healing that you've done with Judy there, Father, which she gets bigger, better and stronger every single day, and less pain-free every day. And we're so thankful for that, that you've taken care of our sister, and you've taken care of Herman, our brother. And we just ask that you continue to remove the stress from him, and that he could just be peaceful and have fine assurance in your arms there, Father. And Father, we pray for his granddaughter, Beth. We know that, I guess she's got cancer now, Father. We just pray that you would, you know, she's had surgery this week, and we just pray that you'd be with her and remove the cancer from her. And again, just be with the Gila family there, that as some of the trials and tribulations that they continue to go through there, Father. We pray for our brother Ronnie, that, you know, with this, some of the medical appointments he has this next coming week, we just pray for answers, that they would find out what is causing some of the conditions that he's having in his life. So we pray for those things to be answered, prayer for him and Shirley and the rest of the family there, and just a pillar of the church here, and we need him here. So we just ask that you be with him and give us some answers there, Father. Father, if there's any other prayer requests that I might have missed this morning, you know the needs and the wants of the people here, Father. We just pray that, you know, you'd be with the families as they travel for Christmas break here. We know many families are traveling to and from, families celebrating Christmas at different times. We just ask that you'd be with them as traveling. And Father, we just ask that you would use the word today, that people would be blessed by the word, and that you'd bless the message today to our mind, body, and spirit. In Jesus Christ, amen.
Do we have any birthdays this week? Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. Anniversaries this week. We will turn to page 185. We will sing all three verses. By me forever, and love me
us for heaven to live with thee there.
You turn over to page 180. We'd like to try something different with this song. We'd like the ladies to sing verse 1 and the chorus, and the men to sing verse 2 and the chorus, and then we'll all come together for verse 3 and the chorus.
So, Aaron? So just the women. Job. A couple of announcements here. We'll start with the children's play Christmas program that is next Sunday. Next Sunday, the 14th, and program is at 1 o'clock, and it is not a luncheon. It is only going to be coffee and cookies. And it will be prepared after the Christmas program. However, after church, so we know service will be at 9. And then from 10 to 1, Patty would like the children to be here, and they'll do a couple drive-through runs. So we just ask that all the children would stay and be with Patty, and they'll practice that one more time before the 1 o'clock program. We have a couple presents, a family in need. We don't need to necessarily say the name, but if you have any sizes of 3T and 4T, can be new or used. They're in need of some clothing for their children, and maybe even presents for like a 4-year-old. If you want want to get something there, and I can make sure it gets to the family if you bring it out to the church. Shirley? Girls? I know one's a girl for sure. So, I don't know. I believe it's, we'll just go with girls for now. Yeah, we could do that also. Yep. But we got breakfast today. Ron's downstairs cooking, doing a good job, so thanks to him. We have communion today. We have the Sisters in Service night out, December 9th. I heard there's like 16. Holy buckets. It's a rowdy group. December 10th, we have Bible study this Wednesday, and the elders meeting will be coming up. If you have anything for the elders meeting, you can put it in the drop box back there and or bring it to one of the elders here, and we'll make sure it gets discussed for church business. So we definitely keep things confidential, and we definitely do discuss the tough subjects. Manor House with Dennis is going to be December 14th. If you want to go with him and Kim and others, I know Jack and Carla help him out, but if you want to go be part of that, I know he's more than welcome, wants people to come. He's the second and fourth Sunday of every month, and then we have Pastor Tom that does Grand Village. I wrote down 2 o'clock. Is that right? Sure. And then we're actually going to start. I'm going to actually do in service at Majestic Pines every Wednesday, every Sunday from starting December 21st. We actually have a service over there. And actually, I'm going to prepare it just like a service here. It'll be a service over there every Sunday at 11. I know there's been many of individuals that said if we change the times, they would be coming. So now I'll pass the word out. Service, Good News Bible Church, will have service at Majestic Pines at 11 a.m. It's open to the public. She said everybody can come, so we will have service here at 9, and we will have service over there at 11 o'clock. So everybody that said they'd be here, if we change the times, please pass the time on. We'd love to see it filled up over there. So that would be good. So as we continue to expand and share the gospel out, that's important. We have the New Year's Eve lock-in. It will be here. We need people to sign up. We're going to do shifts. It will be, we won't have, like, Rachel and Mike and Chad Angels stay in the whole night. We actually want to do like a 6 to 9, 9 to, 9 to midnight, maybe midnight to 3 shifts. Yes? Sure. Sure. So what, there is, okay. Perfect. So I will be there for the message, and then I'm out. I'll be in bed by 9:30. No comment, buddy. Vic Williams is actually going to be there that night, so we're actually going to have the sheriff department, and it's great that we got. Sheriff coming, and it's all about hopefully building connection with our kids and law enforcement. Obviously, you know the news, law enforcement, and been in the news a lot lately, but I think it's important that, you know, they're not our enemies. We need to work with them, and then hopefully our kids can build a connection with them, because I respect our law enforcement community for sure. Let's see here. Anything else for announcements? I think that's it then. Let's do the last song before the message.
We'll turn over to page 195.
Kids can come up here and sing this. We need help with the parents, though. I'll grab you a chair.
There you go.
Silence. put the kids on the spot, but it's fun. I guess Dennis is going to the manor house today. Okay, so 12. So do you do it the first and third? Not the second and fourth? Okay, so it's the first and third Sunday. Perfect. Well, I know you guys have lunch with them. You sit down and have lunch with them. It's great to have coffee, you know, have lunch with the seniors there. So I apologize. And then the kids for the crow program got to be dressed in red and white. So if they could wear red and white clothing, that'd be great. Turn your Bibles open to Psalms 118, verse 8. One of the things I forgot to announce is the Philippines. They had a typhoon go through Category 5. We're a little nervous about people that we've, don't want the typhoon to hit anybody, you know. Last time it hit, it was over, I think, 8,000 people died in the Philippines. But this time it went north. They're just going to get a lot of rain. Psalm 118:8. Today's message is really about wise man or a fool man. So are you considered wise or are you considered a fool? And I guess you can look at it, and we're going to show a comparison today. Are you wise in man's eyes or are you wise in God's eyes? Because if you're wise in man's eyes, you're a fool in God's eyes. If you're wise in God's eyes, you're a fool in man's eyes. And that's really what today's message is all about, this first part of the message. Then we'll get into Romans 8. The last part of Romans 8, all about eternal security. I think you're going to really like it. So the name of the message, wise men or fool men. And let me read Psalms 118:8. It says, it is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. Let's open with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, again, I'm just so thankful that I'm a sinner saved by grace. We say it often here, and we tell people not to believe, you know, any man that stands at the pulpit and read the Word of God or preach. Because we are sinners saved by grace. I'm no better than, no worse than any man. I deserve hell. That's exactly what I deserve. But you know what? I have a Savior that died for me, and I put my trust and faith in Jesus Christ, in His death, burial, and resurrection. I believe that He is saving me. I put my trust and faith in Him. And I know as when I die and I close my eyes here, the last time I close my eyes here on earth will be the first time I open them in heaven to be absent from the body and present with the Lord. And I am so guaranteed of assurance in heaven, over and over, that I know I'm going to heaven when I die. And it's just a blessing to know that my family knows and people can know it too. And so I'd rather not put my trust and faith in any man, what man preaches, but we would rather put our trust in the Lord and what He says. So today's message, Father, is, are you a wise man or a fool's man? So we just ask that You'd bless the message today to our body. In Christ's name, amen. So today we have, as you know, I got a son. I have a son, and he's a junior at Bemidji State University. And my daughter just got accepted to the University of North Dakota. And we know many, like Ron and Chris, their son and daughter are obviously in college right now. And there's a process. You know, there's some of you that have kids in college, and you know there's a process. And during this process of sending applications to get accepted into college, there were many first steps. And one of the first steps in taking tests was taking tests. An example of a test would be ACT or SAT. We know the ACT is the American College Testing, and the SAT is Scholastic Aptitude Test. Both tests measure your readiness to learn at a higher level. Some colleges have a minimum level of ACT and SAT to get in. Sometimes these scores separate small scholarships from very large scholarships. There's a lot of weight placed on some of these tests or assessments that they take. So that's just to get into college. Another test we have in the States is an IQ test, which stands for intelligence quotient. And this test measures reasoning and problem solving. If you have a high enough IQ, you can enter such groups as Mensa, 999 Society, Prometheus Society, and the Mega Society. And each one of them is a higher IQ to get into one of those groups. Man likes to take tests. He likes to categorize individuals as, you know what, you're below intelligence, you're of average intelligence, and you're above average intelligence, and you, obviously you are highly, or maybe me, are highly intelligent, as this person would like to say. And I say, doesn't it sound special to be in a group called Mensa? Wouldn't it be special to be in a group called Mega Society based on IQ? I mean, this is what man does. It obviously likes to create categories, and it obviously likes to elevate himself and is a higher status compared to others. But there are a few of the tests man has developed over the years to separate. So these are just a few to separate himself from others that thinks he's smarter than others. And I would have you turn over to Romans 1:22. And the question is really, it's of today, is are you a wise man or are you a fool's man? That is a good question. Because here in the Bible, Romans 1:22, it says, professing themselves to be wise. Well, I'm in the Mensa Society. I have IQ of 160 or above. Or I'm in the Mega Society. I'm in the top 0.002 percentile. I'm one of the 26 smartest men in the world. And I'm not putting down intelligence, but I'm putting down these categories that obviously like man likes to put themselves into. Professing themselves to be wise, they become fools. And I am not, obviously we live in a society and you need to have higher learning today to even move on, but obviously I think our higher institutions are completely anti-God, are completely Christ haters, and it scares me to send our children to some of these schools where obviously we have, you know, some individuals that are telling these our kids that there is no God, or that you got to be open and there's, you know, many pathways to heaven and this and that, and it's a bunch of garbage. But the question is not if you score a 25 on your ACT or an 1800 on an SAT, or you have an IQ of 100 or above. The real question is if you're considered wise or not. You can be defined as a wise man by man, or you can be defined as a wise man by God, and I would say, which do you prefer? This is what God has to say about men who call themselves wise. Turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18. Because if you're trusting in Christ as your Savior, you're definitely a fool in man's eyes. You know, I would say the lost. Obviously, a saved person would be like, if I'm looking at you and you're trusted in Christ as your Savior, obviously I'm looking at you as a wise man. But the world, the lost, looks at you as to be obviously a fool. Because it tells us here, for the preaching of the cross is to them that preach foolishness. Oh, you're going to trust in that? But unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. We know it is the only thing that saves is the gospel of Christ. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and I will bring to nothing that understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of the preaching to save them that believe. This is the only way. This is what God wants. It's only one way, and it has to be that simple to save us. Because we would screw it up if we had to do anything. For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks, they seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified. Here we have the gospel. Under the Jews, a stumbling block, and under the Greeks, foolishness. And don't we see that today? We see that, and you can see Jews there in religious circles of the world, that obviously it is a stumbling block. It can't be that easy. You must go to the front of the church, and you must confess Jesus Lord of your life. You must get baptized. You must ask Him into your heart. You got to stop sinning. You got to turn from sin. You got to give up chewing. You got to give up smoking. You got to do something. It's a stumbling block to the religious circles of the world. But we preach Christ who's crucified, and none of the Jews a stumbling block, and none of the Greeks foolishness. And that is our higher learning institutions today, the philosophers. If God was real, then can He make a rock so big that He can't lift? If He's all powerful, then He should be able to make a rock that He can't lift. I had a philosopher teacher tell me that in a class one time. And that was his logic, that was his reasoning, that basically God wasn't real, because if God was real, and if He was all-powerful, He could make a rock that He couldn't lift. And it was, and if He couldn't lift it, then He really wasn't God. I mean, it's like, what a stupid debate, basically. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men. And the weakness of God is stronger than men. For you see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. Obviously, you see a lot of pride in there. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. And we see that today. You can have an IQ of 180, 200. You know, you're talking the top 100,000ths, 100,000ths, or a thousandth of a 1%, and they don't get it. Obviously, they do not get it, and that obviously tells us in 27, but God had chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and it's really sad. In 28, and base things of the world, and these things which are despised, hath God chosen, yes, and things which are not, to bring to not things that are, that no flesh should glory in His presence. But of Him are you in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, redemption, that according as it is written, He that glorifieth, let him glory in the Lord. Grace preaching, right there, 31. It is not something that you can boast about. If there's any glorying, the glorying goes to Christ, our Lord and Savior, or the glorying goes to the Father, for they've done it all. Now you can be called a wise man among men and be called a fool from God, or you can be called a wise man from God and a fool from men. And the question is, which is it? Christ Jesus tasted death. Hebrews 2:9, we're not going to turn over there yet, but I say Christ Jesus tasted death for every man. What does that mean? When Christ Jesus went to the cross of Calvary, this means that every living person's sins of past, present, future were placed on the cross, on Christ at Calvary. He died for the sins of mankind. He didn't die just for the good Christian, the holy rollers, the good people. He died for the immoral sinner, the one who committed murders, the one who committed rape, the one who hurts children. There isn't one person that Christ Jesus didn't die for. He tasted death for every man. Look at Hebrews 2:9. It tells us that. What a great verse. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that He, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. Think about that. That means people go to hell with their sins paid for. Nobody should have to go to hell. All the sins of mankind have already been paid for. It is a finished work in Christ. Yet people are a little too proud. Maybe they think they're too smart, and they think it is foolishness, the preaching of the cross. But to prove Christ Jesus tasted death for every man, Christ Jesus was buried. To show the world that he died, however, to show the world that God the Father was satisfied with the payment of sin from his Son, Christ Jesus resurrected for our justification. He resurrected to show us our sin is paid in full by his death payment on the cross of Calvary. And when you believe in the gospel of salvation, his death payment on the cross for the sins of mankind, his burial, resurrection, and nothing else, you are born again. You are born into the family of God. You become his son or daughter, and once a child, forever a child. And I would say turn over to Romans 1:23. And the thing is, you know, when I was a kid, I actually had a crucifix. And that's, you know, between me and you, that's up to you. But I personally don't like crucifixes. They're leaving Christ on the cross. And when I read Romans 1:23, this is why I don't like crucifixes. 23, it says, "And change the glory of the uncorruptible God into image made like a corruptible man." And the thing, it's important that he is not on the cross. I think it's important to note that he's not on the cross anymore. Because if you leave him on the cross, then I think that's confusing to people, and they think they got to do something, for he didn't do the finished work on the cross. And he is no longer in the tomb, for he is risen. We read that in Matthew. The angel says he is risen. So let me say, Christ Jesus is not on the cross, as some religions portray him. Christ Jesus is not in the tomb, for he was resurrected and he ascended into heaven. And he sits at the right hand of God today. We know that. It says it in Psalms. It says it in Hebrews. Today showing us he has done it all. There is no other way to get to heaven than believe what Christ Jesus has done for you. You can't be good to go to heaven, can't follow commandments. We studied the commandments last week in Ezekiel chapter 20, or Exodus chapter 20, Deuteronomy 5, and we know right after the commandments is sacrifices, for God knew you couldn't keep the law. Then if you read on in Exodus 21, it's a death payment when you violate. That's why they went to the altar every single day, obviously, to sacrifice these lambs. There's no way you could be good enough. There's no other way to get to heaven than believe what Christ Jesus has done for you. Can't be good enough, can't follow commandments to get to heaven, be baptized, or take communion. Now, if you believe this, the gospel of salvation, you are a wise man. For wise men seek out Christ, and the world will call you foolish. However, I would rather trust God than man. And I read Psalms 118:8 again. It says, "It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man." This is why I always say I'm a sinner saved by grace. I don't deserve heaven. I actually deserve hell. There's nothing I can do to earn salvation. However, if I want to pay for my sins, and this goes for people that are not saved, if they want to pay for their sins and reject the redemptive works of Christ, their Lord and Savior, they will have to go to hell and pay for those sins for all eternity. Hell is real. It's no joke. Only a fool would want to go to hell and pay for his or her sins for all eternity. However, I have already believed and can never lose myself, and because Christ Jesus already paid for all my sins, the sins that I have not yet committed, he's paid for them all. And I believe. And I know I'm sealed by the Holy Spirit of promise, placed in Christ's hands, and not only in his hands, but the Father's hands. I don't know if you've ever received an email from Eddie Forsman, but when he closes his emails with "in his grip," and I would close my emails "in Christ," "in his grace," things like that, but one day I was thinking about it. He ends his emails with "in his grip, Eddie." And one day I was thinking of that, and now sometimes I end my emails in the same way. And if you think about it, you are in his grip. And I love that. One day I was reading it, and I'm like, man, that is awesome. That is awesome. So are you a fool in man's eyes or a wise man in God's eyes? Or are you a wise man in man's eyes and a fool in God's eyes? See, there's actually a story that talks about wise men. Turn over to Matthew chapter 2. question is, are you a wise man or a wise woman, or a fool's man or a fool's woman? Matthew chapter 2, verse 1 and 2. And Willie and I were talking before the church. Willie actually said, you know, he had a friend that actually we prayed for a couple months ago, and she's actually cancer-free. And I forgot to give thanks about that in opening prayer this morning. And but he said, you know, we're singing Christmas songs. And he says, man, it gets you in the spirit. It gets you in the mood for Christmas. And I love singing. I've been waiting for a while to sing some of these Christmas songs. And I love reading, you know, this story here. But the main point I want to point out is the wise men part of this story. It says, now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship. See, these wise men come to worship their Savior. For they knew Christ Jesus comes to die on the cross for the sins of mankind. How do I know that? Turn actually about five verses before that. Look at Matthew 1:21. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. So you considered a wise man or a fool's man? Look at verse 3 in Matthew 2. When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet. And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor, and thou shalt rule my people Israel. Then Herod, when he had privately called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search diligently for the young child, and when you have found him, bring me word again that I may come and worship him also. When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother. And here's a key piece here. And they fell down and worshipped him. Not mom, not Mary. They worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. So again, pointing out the Savior is they came to worship the Savior, and they did not worship Mary, for they knew Christ Jesus was the Savior, and that he was going to die for the sins and resurrect the third day. It is interesting that they bring him gold and frankincense and myrrh. Gold obviously representing his kingship, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Frankincense celebrating life. And ultimately myrrh would be death. Those three gifts that they bring represent his kingdom. He is King of Kings, obviously his life, eternal life that he offers, but ultimately his death with myrrh. I think it's interesting that they offer those three gifts. But wise men come to seek Jesus. And let me read Matthew 1:21 again. It says, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. And I would say, did you know Mary was a wise woman? Mary was a wise woman. Why do I say that? Because I look it over in Luke chapter 1. Because she was a sinner, and she needed a Savior, just like you and I. And Mary in chapter 1 of Luke, verse 46 and 47, it says, and Mary said, my soul doth magnify the Lord. My spirit hath rejoiced in God my Savior. See, Mary was a sinner just like you and I. But she was a wise woman. And the question is, are you a wise man today like these wise men portrayed in the Bible and believe you are a sinner and know you can never be good enough, never do any deed, ritual, sacrament to save self? Do you know you need a Savior today, and today you can be born again? Today you can know you have eternal life and never lose it. Today you can know you will be absent from the body and present with the Lord. And there's nothing better to know that if you have a child or a spouse or a mom and dad, that if they were to die, that you know they're absolutely in heaven. That's important to know. Because one day you're going to be sitting in a pew and your loved one will be in a casket. And the question you will ask is, are they saved or not? Where are they? And oftentimes you hear, oh, I hope they're in a better place. Well, you can know. Present with the Lord because you believe Christ Jesus died on the cross for your sins. He was buried and for you, and he resurrected for you, showing you that your sin is paid in full. If you believe this, you're eternally secure, forever child of God, and we'll see our Heavenly Father, Christ Jesus, and you're a wise man in God's eyes and a fool in the lost man's eyes. Do you believe God and become a member of the most elite group? Not Mensa, not the Mega Society, not Prometheus, but you'll become a member of the most elite group, and that is a child of God, a family of God, and we would call that the Lord's army. I think that is the most greatest group to be part of, is to be called a son of God, to be standing here today saying, I am a child of God. That is the greatest group to be part of. But if you're sitting here and you're lost today and you're not saved, and I would ask that you look at this. Let this hand here represent you and I, and this wallet represents our sin. God loves us, hates our sin. Why does he hate our sin? Because it keeps us separated from him. You got to be perfect to get into heaven. And yet many people today will try to cover it up, try to remove it. The Bible is very clear that the payment for sin is death. Can't turn from it. Can't stop. Still there. But let this hand here represent Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. God, from eternity past, let us make man in our image. God the Father, God the Spirit, and the Son, from eternity past. He reveals himself in the flesh. And he humbled himself as a man, yet fully God. He went to the cross. He shed his blood. And then he died and he rose again the third day, showing his payment for sin and paid in full. The perfection that you need to get into heaven is right here. It's not by doing any deed or ritual. It is by believing. For by grace are you saved through faith, not of yourself. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. This gift of righteousness, of justification, of sanctification, is received in Christ Jesus. When you believe the gospel of your salvation, his righteousness is put to your account. You're seen as righteous as Christ, as perfect as Christ. It's no longer a sin question, but a son question. So are you a wise man amongst men, or are you a wise man amongst God? Turn to Romans chapter 8. We're going to finish Romans 8 today. And it's 8:28. We left off a couple weeks ago. And if you're not saved, I mean, this is all about grace living. It's really about growing up in the Lord. We know that you talk about, people say, oh, I need the meat. I want to grow up. You got to feed me more than milk. Well, ultimately, that is between you and the Lord. You'll never grow if you're not reading. You can't show up once a week and just listen to a service and think you're mature in Christ. It ain't going to happen. You have to read the Bible. And the Lord wants you to read. He wants to have a personal relationship with you. And that's what Romans is all about talking here. It's about growing up in grace. Romans 8:28 starts off here. And we know Romans 6, how it tells us here, if you've not been here in a while, Romans 6 shows us how we're identified in his death, how we're identified in his burial, and we're identified in his resurrection. It is as if we were there when they crucified him. We're dead to sin. Sin no longer has a dominion over you. See, before you were saved, that had control. You had no excuse because that's all you knew how to do is sin. But ultimately, there is no more excuse. Yes, we sin till we die. I know that. But you know what? You can keep your mind on Christ. You can remain in fellowship. And it all comes about transforming your mind by reading the Word of God. And that's key. Romans 7 says, is all about this battle that happens in you, this old nature, this new nature, this battle of having, I do the things that I don't want to do and don't do the things that I should do. And he's trying to do, and he's trying to live this Christian lifestyle all by himself, as Romans 7, he's trying to do it all by himself. The new nature has a desire, but it's weak. You cannot live this Christian lifestyle, pump it out on your own. And that's where Romans 8 comes in. It's the Holy Spirit. And it's about yielding, reading the Word of God, feeding the Holy. It's Him, the power. It is Him. Those are the fruits working through you. That's what Romans 8 is all about. Having victory daily. So we read in Romans 8:28, when you know all the things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are in the called according to His purpose. And this is review. But the question, the comment is, if you love God, you will know that all things are not always good. However, all things work together for good. For example, religious leaders of the time plotted Jesus' death, plotted to kill Him, and this is not good. However, Christ Jesus going to the cross, dying for the sins of mankind, buried, resurrected the third day, is good for man. For if Christ had not died for the sins of mankind, none of us could go to heaven. For example, have you ever attended a funeral and heard people say, how can God take a child? How can God make someone suffer? How can God do this or do that? Man is quick to blame God, but if you love Him, you understand that He works all things together for good. Never easy to lose a loved one. Never easy to see someone we love suffer, which is not good. However, God is working all things together for good. You might not understand the rhyme or reason at the time, but know God works all things for good. Know that. God wants you to know all that all things might not be good, but He works all things together for good. God knows exactly what it takes for an individual to be broken to the point where they will accept God, the gospel of salvation. Maybe it took for this person to suffer. Maybe it took for that person to die or this person to suffer so they could get saved. So all things might not be good. However, God works all things together for good. And if you love Him, He wants you to know this. We look at Romans 8, 29 and 30. He says, for whom He did foreknow, He also did predestinate. So here we're going to get into the topic of predestination, Calvinistic approach. He did conform to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom He did predestinate, them He also called. And whom He called, them He also justified. And whom He justified, them He also glorified. God the Father does not predestinate who is saved and who is going to hell. That is not what it's saying. He doesn't say, this group of people here are going to go to heaven before they were created, and this people here are going to go to hell. He doesn't predestinate anybody to heaven or hell. God the Father said before the creation of the earth was laid, He said the elect, and the elect are saved, will be in Christ Jesus. The chosen are in Christ Jesus. It is free choice. You can decide if you want to be in Christ or not. You can be part of the elect or not, if you want to be the chosen or not. But He says if you want to be part of the chosen, if you want to be elect, you got to believe. So God the Father does not predestinate anyone to heaven or hell. However, before the foundation of the earth was laid, He laid out the process of salvation. Before the foundation of the earth was laid, He said, this is the plan of salvation. It was not one day when Moses sinned or when Abraham sinned, God says, or when Adam and Eve in the garden sinned, He didn't just want to say, okay, now I got to figure out a way how to save man. Oh, I'm going to have Jesus go. No. From eternity past, the plan of salvation was always about Jesus Christ. Ephesians 1:4, He says, according as He hath chosen us in Him, we're chosen in Him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy without blame before Him in love. We receive that righteousness in Christ. So before the foundation of the earth was laid, the plan of salvation was already laid out. So notice in verse 30, it is a guarantee. The ones who are justified will be glorified. Look at that, guaranteed. And whom He justified, them He also glorified. guaranteeing a picture of eternal security. If you believe Christ Jesus died on the cross for your sins, for you, he was buried for you, he was risen for you, justified, and one day he will be glorified. One day you will be glorified, for one day we have a new body. The corruption, this corruption must put on incorruption. Obviously, this mortal must put on immortality. We read that in 1 Corinthians 15. We will be given a new glorified body one day where we will never die, never be sick, never have any aches or pains, or forever. Forever we, believers, people who believe in the finished work of Christ, will be with the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So the process of salvation is the same from eternity past to eternity future. And now he has six questions. Paul is going to ask six questions here that will be asked and answered to know you have eternal life. Six questions. Let me read the questions. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? How shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? Who is he that condemneth? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? These are the questions that he asks in 31, obviously over to 36 there, 37. Let me read Romans 8:31. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? What shall we say to these things? We should sing praises all day long to our Lord and Savior. Who is against us? It is Satan. And his demonic forces are against us. However, Satan does not win the battle or the war. Satan loses the battle, he loses the war, and knows he's defeated. Our Heavenly Father is for us, and it tells us how much he is for us in verse 32. He that spared not his own Son, but delivered him up for us all. You see, he tasted death. The Bible has no contradiction. He tasted death for all. He delivered him up for us all. How shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Our Heavenly Father is for the believers. No one can oppose believers successfully because God spared not even his own Son for us all. If he gave his own Son, what is he willing not to give us? Nothing. We receive everything in Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. We receive eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Verse 33, who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who shall lay anything to charge of God's elect? No one, for the judge. No one. For the judge has the final say. Who is justified and who is not justified? The judge knows who come to him by faith. The judge knows who to come to him by faith and believe in the finished work of Christ. For Jesus died on the cross for this person's sins and resurrected. The sins of this person have already been judged. And when you come to Christ by faith, you are no longer seen a guilty sinner. There are no more accusations. There are no more charges against you because you are justified. You are not guilty. Romans 3:24 says, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. So who shall lay anything against me? Yeah, maybe I have man that might accuse me, but you know what? It is God that does the justifying. I cannot lose my salvation. And I would say, isn't that beautiful? Justified freely by his grace through the ransom paid in Christ Jesus. And I would say, how can you hate Christ Jesus? How can you hate Christ Jesus and not see the love he has for you, for he died for you and resurrected for you? Why would you hate Christ Jesus when he died for your sins? He paid the penalty that you owe, and yet he did this for you before you knew yourself. And all you have to do is believe, because it is freely given to you by grace through faith in the finished work. Yet we have Christ haters today. Look at Romans 8:34. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again. Obviously the gospel right there. Who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us? So who is the one that condemns? Who has the power? It is Christ Jesus who is the judge. We know John 5:22, it says, for the Father judges no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son. Christ Jesus is the judge. However, Christ Jesus is the one who also died. So we see that in 33. He's the judge, but he's also the one that died for the sins of mankind. He's risen and sits at the right hand of God, and he intercedes on our behalf. The one that condemns is the one who also saves. That is Christ Jesus. Nobody else can condemn a person except Christ Jesus. And if you have not believed, you're condemned already. We know that in John 3:16 through 18. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. However, if you have believed in the finished work of Christ Jesus, you are alive. And Christ Jesus is not only alive, but we have a Savior today that intercedes on our behalf every day, guaranteeing our eternal life in heaven. We have everlasting life because Christ Jesus has everlasting life." And we're going to have to end. I know I'd like to get through Romans here. We can answer these questions next week, but I do not want to rush Romans 35 through 39. Let's do communion. If I could have four elders up here, and we'll take communion. If you want to follow along, you can do 1 Corinthians 11. We know communion doesn't save anybody. It's like baptism. We partake in communion today because it's a remembrance. It's a celebration of what Christ Jesus has done for us. And I love it. It's a celebration to thank God that God loved us so much that he sent his son, provided a sin bearer for us, and his name is Christ Jesus. So we will open with 1 Corinthians 11:23. It says, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks," and we're going to open with prayer, but I'm going to let Herman, would you open in prayer, please?
Father, we thank you for what your Son, Jesus Christ, did on the cross. He made it possible for us to have salvation, and we're so thankful for that, Father. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
We'll handle the bread, and we'll partake in it together. when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." Pass out the juice. After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me." Buddy, would you stand and then turn to the congregation and close us in prayer, please, buddy? Thank you, buddy. Thanks, everybody. We'll see you all next Sunday for sure. We'll all stand and close on page 314.
Coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more. clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. And I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day, that will be. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear. No more sickness, no pain, no more parting over there. And forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. And I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the